Yeah, for those of you who have missed some of the past shows, when my internet connection goes out and I'll be going and don't realize it, get way too far in. All right, so we're going to start in Genesis chapter 10. We're going to start with scripture. And this is important because a lot of the times when people teach who's who in the Bible, they don't want to go back to scripture when it doesn't add up in modern times. And so it's important to go back to scripture because people will come to you and say, well, let me help you because this doesn't really mean this. And what you're reading isn't actually what you're seeing. So let me re-explain it to you so it fits this narrative. But the word of God is going to be true and every man is going to be a liar. Genesis 10, 1. And we're just going to read verses 1 through 5. Let me move this thing out the way. I don't know if y'all can see that, but I can. All right. Now, these are the generations of the sons of Noah, Shem, Ham, and Japheth, and unto them were sons born after the flood. The sons of Japheth, Gomer, and Magog, and Madai, and Javan, and Tubal, and Meshech, and Tyrus. And the sons of Gomer, Ashkenaz, who we're going to be focusing on today, and Riphath, and Togarmah. And the sons of Javan, Elisha, and Tarshish, and Kittim, and Dodanim. By these were the isles of the Gentiles divided in their lands, every one after his tongue, after their families in their nations. So real quick, when we get to Kittim, we're not going to talk about Kittim today or Esau, but we find that there is a mixing that happens later. And so we will talk about that and why some people believe that Esau is the white man, even though I don't believe that's 100% true. I believe that some are, but not all. So we're going to talk about Ashkenaz. So Ashkenaz is from the line of Japheth. He is the son of Japheth's son, Gomer. And it says, by these were the isles of the Gentiles divided in their lands, everyone after his tongue, after their families, in their nations. So now, when we bring this verse out, or these verses out, the common response is that Ashkenaz, the Ashkenazi, are not really Ashkenazi, but they are from the line of Shem. They are Israelites. Now, I'm giving you guys the narrative that we are given. They are Israelites from the tribe of Shem that migrated into Germany and then started calling themselves the Ashkenazi, which is adopted from the name of one of the lineage, one of the males in the lineage of Japheth, but they're not actually from Japheth. They're actually Shemites. So we should recognize them as the true people of the book. That sounds reasonable to them until you ask them, okay, so if they are the real people, then what happened to the Ashkenazi? The original Ashkenaz or Ashkenazi, if these other people came over and started claiming it, and now they're the real Jews, what happened to the original Ashkenaz or Ashkenazi? They have no answers for that. I don't know. They don't once think that, hey, maybe these people are the people and they're just lying about who they are. Instead, they assume that it's black people lying about who we are based on nothing more than our skin color. Because again, none of these people know us personally. They don't know our family history. So when a black person with black skin, of course, says we're Israel, they immediately say you're lying. Ask yourself, what do they base it on to call us a liar if they don't know us personally, they don't know our genetic history, and they don't know our family history? The only thing left from visual appearance alone is race. These are the people making it about race, and they want to deceive everybody else into believing that we're the ones making it about race, when in fact, we're the ones making it about truth. So scripture says, whether people like it or not, that Ashkenaz is the grandson of Japheth. Ashkenaz is identified among the Gentiles that by these were the isles of the Gentiles divided in their land. So he's identified in that group. So we're going to keep going. So here, some of you have seen this before. Let me go ahead and drop this link right here. This is from safaria.org. And this comes from chapter 24 of Pirkei de Rabbi. Some of you guys have seen this before. Give me a second here. Thank you, Sean Fleming, in the super chat. Appreciate you. Been looking forward to this. Yeah, me too. I've been backed up with all kind of stuff going on. So yeah, chapter 24, I just dropped the link in the chat so you guys can check it later. Again, for those who's going to ask me later after you listen to this, where are the links? They're in the chat, the live chat. All right. So now we're going to read Nimrod, the Tower of Babel. This is important because this is the theology that many of us came out of identifying who is who in the Bible. Now, they'll tell us that our identity has to be in Christ and that should be enough. And yet, when we read the Bible, God went through enough trouble to identify people by lineage and tell us who was related to who and how they were related. He identified groups of people as important to Bible prophecy. And yet these people are telling us it's no longer important who these groups of people are, and the Bible prophecy part doesn't matter, and it's okay to lie about identity. But I'm gonna show you guys something. So some of you guys have seen this, Nimrod and the Tower of Babel. Noah brought his sons and his grandsons, and he blessed them with their several settlements, and he gave them as an inheritance all the earth. He especially blessed Shem and his sons, making them dark but comely. So right there, we're told Shem is dark but lovely. This is similar to the language used in Song of Solomon, chapter 1, verses 5 and 6, where she says, I am black. But lovely, black, but comely. It says, and he gave them the habitable earth. He blessed Ham and his sons, making them dark like the raven. And he gave them as an inheritance the coast of the sea. So now we see that Shem and Ham are dark. We've gone over the Shemite stuff in the last undeniable presentation. So if you guys want to see that stuff, go back and watch it. So now here's the important part. He blessed Japheth and his sons, making them entirely white, and he gave them for an inheritance the desert and its fields. These are the inheritance with which he endowed them. So now, the first thing we see is identifying colors. So you could look at people and see who was Japheth. And then you could see who was either Ham or Shem based solely on skin color by looking at them alone. How do we know? Because Shem was dark, Ham was dark, Japheth was white. A clear visual distinction. This to me is common sense. And so many of us were told when coming up in the Christian church that Ham is black, that Shem is brown or Middle Eastern, and that Japheth is white. This is the narrative that we were given. And so now when we start digging more into the narrative, suddenly they want to change the narrative. Suddenly they want to tell us that we're wrong and we're making it about race, when that can't possibly be true, when all we have been fed is the idea that Hamites are black, Shemites are brown, and Japheth is white. And then we are told that these people over here who look white to me are really Shem, and they're olive. And then we say, wait, olives come in green and black. And they say, oh, well, they look Middle Eastern. Well, then we find out the Middle East wasn't even a thing until the 1800s. They weren't even calling it the Middle East. It was known as North Africa. It was part of Africa. And by tectonic plate definition, it is Africa. If you look at the how the tectonic plates flow, it's Africa. So they keep moving the goalposts, which is what they've always done. So give me a second here to pull up this other thing. All right. So now we're going to get back into this. Let me give you guys the link one more time before I close this tab, because I got a lot of tabs open. So I'm closing them down as we go. So this thing hopefully won't freeze. All right, so now that's the safaria.org link that I just posted right there. If you guys want to go read that for yourself, 364 people in live. Make sure you hit that thumbs up and make sure you share this. All right, I'm going to share my screen again. And we're going to start digging into some of the stuff that the other people said. So right now we're just reading scripture and commentary and just using common sense. All right, so I'm closing this one down. So now let's talk about the 13th tribe and Arthur Koestler. They wanted to debunk Koestler so bad because Koestler exposed a lot of stuff. In this book, let me go over here, Arthur Koestler, The 13th Tribe, The Khazar Empire and Its Heritage. It says The 13th Tribe is a 1976 book by Arthur Koestler, in which the author advances the thesis that the Ashkenazi Jews are not descended from historical Israelites of antiquity, but from Khazars, a Turkic people. So now, this is 1976. He said this, right? And so you will find that the urban apologist and some of the other people, the Zionists, as many people call them, will try to debunk Kessler's work. So I already know what I'm walking into by referencing Kessler. But understand, Kessler isn't the only thing I'm bringing forth. This is where I'm starting at after we looked at scripture and some commentary. So now I'm going to read a couple of paragraphs from this preview right here. This is from Goodreads. Let me go ahead and give you guys the link so you have that. Make sure you guys save these links. Here we go. So now Kessler says this about the time when Charlemagne was crowned emperor of the West, the eastern confines of Europe between the Caucasus and the Volga were ruled by a Jewish state known as the Khazar Empire. At the peak of its power from the 7th to the 10th centuries, it played a significant part in shaping the destinies of medieval and consequently of modern Europe. The Byzantine Empire and the historian Constantine, 913 to 959, must have been well aware of this when he recorded in his treatise on court protocol that letters addressed to the Pope in Rome and similarly those to the Emperor of the West had a gold seal worth 2 solidi attached to them, whereas messages to the King of the Khazars displayed a seal worth 3 solidi. This was not flattery, but real politic in the period with which we are concerned, wrote Barry. It is probable that the Khan of the Khazars was of little less importance in the view of the imperial foreign policy than Charles the Great and his ancestors. The country of the Khazars, a people of Turkish stock, occupied a strategic position at the vital gateway between the Black Sea and the Caspian, where the great Eastern powers of the period confronted each other. It acted as a buffer protecting Byzantium against invasions by the lusty barbarian tribesmen of the northern steppes, burglars, Magyars, Pechenegs, etc., and later the barbarian the Vikings and the Russians. But equally or even more important, both from the point of view of Byzantine diplomacy and of European history, is the fact that the Khazar armies effectively blocked the Arab avalanche in its most devastating early stages and thus prevented the Muslim conquest of Eastern Europe. Professor Dunlop of Columbia University, a leading authority on the history of the Khazars, has given a concise summary of the decisive yet virtually unknown episode. So anyway, I guess I'll read the rest of this because it's not a good place to really stop, but I'll read down to here. Now, you know what? I'll start here. You guys can read this for yourself. I'll give you the link, but right here, this paragraph, you got a little bit of history of the Khazars. It says, what is in dispute is the fate of the Jewish Khazars after the destruction of their temple in the 12th or 13th century. On this problem, the sources are scant, but various late medieval Khazar settlements are mentioned in the Crimea, in the Ukraine, in Hungary, Poland, and Lithuania. The general picture that emerges from these fragmentary pieces of information is that a migration of Khazar tribes and communities into those regions of Eastern Europe, mainly Russia and Poland, were at the dawn of the modern age, the greatest concentration of Jews were found. This has led several historians to conjecture that a substantial part, perhaps the majority of Eastern Jews and hence of world Jewry, might be of Khazar and not Semitic origin.